more low-key than what modular forms. It's much more direct. I want to explain to you what evidence we found in favor of it. And then while this, if you wish, establishes it to a certain extent, it doesn't explain it, at least the way I want to think about it. And therefore, we want to try to start to understand it from the point of view of the geometry of K3 surfaces or K3 sigma models. And I'll explain to you the advances we have made and the shortcomings that this point of view shows. And then at the very end, I want to explain to you some more recent developments that maybe point to a slightly different point of view. So let me start by saying that here it's great that Hiroshi explained what the signal model of K3 looks like. So he explained to you that there is an N=4 superconformal field theory on the left and on the right. And therefore the spectrum of the theory can be written as a direct sum of representations of two N=4 superconformal algebras, the left moving algebra and the right moving algebra. So the full spectrum of states will be of that form. If this N=4 superconformal algebra he briefly describes as a Virzoro algebra, then there's an SC2 affine algebra, and then that's possible. Now this is what we expect the sigma model for K3 to look like, but we actually know this explicitly only at very, very isolated points in the moduli space. So what we should try to do is look at a somewhat more coarse-grained point of view about these sigma models that doesn't depend so much on the very detailed which incarnation we are looking at. So let me remind you that there is a moduli space of these K3 sigma models. So this is believed to be described by this. This is something called Kasmanian, describing for you how a four-dimensional subspace sits inside a 24-dimensional subspace of signature 4,20. And then you have some underlying charge lattice and some discrete automorphisms of that charge lattice. And you want to be the moduli are the positions of this four-plane modulo, the identifications that come from this discrete. So for each such sigma model, we should expect the spectrum to be of that form, but as I said, we don't actually know explicitly except for very few points. And therefore, what we should do, we should look at some sort of partial index, something we have better under control, and this is the elliptic genus which also Hiroshi and Harvey described. So this is the trace of the Riemannian one sector of this spectrum, so it's a certain part of this spectrum. And then you have the insertion of these generators. These are the generators of the N=4 superconformal algebra. The things without the bar are the left movers, the things with the bar are the right movers. And then this is formally a function of Q, as always this morning, it's the 2 pi tau, and Y is equal to 2 pi z. And it doesn't actually depend on tau bar for the reason that because of this -1 for the F bar, and the fermionic zero for the right movers has the tangent each other, unless they're annihilated by all fermionic zero modes. But if there are annihilated by all fermionic zero modes, then it follows from the commutation relations of the algebra that L0 bar is equal to C/24, and therefore this coefficient is trivial, and therefore this is actually a function of tau. So what's nice about it is that it's constant in a moduli space. Half the reason for that is that on abstract grounds, it's equal to a mean Jacobi form of weight 0 and index 1. And as we also heard this morning, there's only one such animal, and therefore this answer must be equal to this up to a constant. I suppress the factor of 2 in an unconventional normalization of this feature Jacobi form. And because this would vary continuously as you vary a moduli space and integers can't jump, it must always be the same. So this is the reason in some sense why it's constant over moduli space. It's a little more coarse-grained knowledge about this K3 signal. So I probably don't actually have to review what the feature Jacobi form is because that was done this morning by Montagnier. So this is just a very quick reminder. This is the modular property, and then there is this spectral flow-like property. But this is exactly the same as the one that I gave us this morning. Okay, so we want to, so as I said, by going to the elliptic genus, in some sense we look at the piece of the spectrum, because as I explained to you, only the states contributed by L0 bar is equal to minus C over equal to C bar over 24. In this case, C bar is actually equal to 6. But never mind. But what this means is that out of this full space of states, you only keep the states that are right moving ground states. But what you have are still states that form a full representation of the left moving N=4 superconformal algebra. So the space of states, which I like to call BPS states, which is a piece of this full space of states that are right moving ground states, you can still write in terms of representations of the N=4 superconformal algebra. Because you've only identified some characteristic with respect to the right moving. So this is the structure of this space. There's a coefficient of that. These are the various N=4 representations that were also briefly reviewed this morning. And the multiplicity moduli space, but the multiplicity space with which these other massive representations of n equals to 4 appear, they will vary over moduli space, they will jump up and down. They're not constant over moduli space, because the elliptic genus isn't just a trace over these multiplicity spaces, because these multiplicity spaces still carry an action of minus 1 to the f bar, and it's only the trace over minus 1 to the f bar of these spaces that's a constant. So when you go to the quantity that corresponds to the elliptic genus, you would calculate the trace over these multiplicity spaces with minus 1 to the f bar, and then the numbers you get out are constant. That is just the fact that the elliptic genus is constant over moduli space. And due to this language, the observation of Ekuchi, Oguri, and Hachikawa about 2 years ago was that the first of these two coefficients you can write as a direct sum of the sums of dimensions of irreducible representations of the material group. Sorry?
Proper subgroups of M23, and there's nowhere in the model.
M24. There are 16 classes that have representatives in N23. There are 10 classes that have no representatives in N23. And of the 16 classes, these ones can be realized as a symmetry of a K3 surface somewhere in moduli space, and the rest aren't. So this geometric point sees a little piece of M23, but it certainly doesn't see all of it. But obviously you would say this is just classical geometry, and I'm looking at string theory, so I should really look at sigma models, and that's what I'll be able to do later on. I want to think about it in terms of the way we should really think about it in this context, and in sigma model symmetries, and I'll explain to you later on what the symmetries of these sigma model K3s are. But before I come to that, I would first want to explain to you in which sense we know that the decomposition we proposed or we found is the correct one. So let me briefly explain to you how you can be confident that these decompositions of the first three multiplicity spaces I wrote down is the correct. So this has to do with giving some evidence of what you do, so that was also alluded to this morning, that you should look at the analog of the McKay-Thompson series. So this is in the spirit of a monstrous moonshine. So what you should do is you see these ANs, we've now written them in terms of RN, so RNs are representations of the, AN is the dimension of RN, and RN are these representations of M24. So this was the 45 plus 45 bar, and this was the 231 plus 231, which surprisingly didn't give 462, and so on. So what I can do is I can, in this elliptic genus, I can replace the dimensions by the traces of over these representations by a group element in M24. So if there was an action of M24 on the underlying vector space or PPS space that contributes to the elliptic genus, what this would correspond to would be to insert the group element G inside this trace that calculates the elliptic genus. Because you see, if I calculate this, I could decompose it into n equals to 4 representations, and then G would commute with the n equals to 4 algebras, it would just act on the multiplicity space, and then I calculate that, it would just amount to replacing this coefficient by the trace of the corresponding representation with the action of G. But obviously I don't know yet whether I have an action of G on this space of PPS state, so this is just sort of looking ahead how I would like to think about this. But so the question is, how do I know what these Kronig genera are? And the answer is, at first I don't know, but I know a few constraints, and I can find to look for a solution that satisfies all the constraints I know. So that's what we've been doing. So let me say what the constraints are. Well, first of all, there are specific K3 sigma models that have interesting symmetries from which you can actually calculate the elliptic genus if you find symmetries explicitly, and if you calculate the elliptic genus with the insertion of the group element, and you get certain numbers. So this is, in particular, was done by Sen and Sen and collaborators before this whole Matthieu Moonshine business started. And then this is sort of some input data in what some of these Twining genera will look like. Now the second answer comes from the fact that according to the Kikuchi or Kuritachi Okawa decomposition, for those RM, you know which representations there are, you know what you have to replace it by. So for these first two coefficients, you know precisely what you have to write down. And then the third constraint comes from the modular properties, which you would expect this quantity to have if it really does come from the trace over some space of states with the insertion of a group. So let me briefly explain to you what these modular properties are. So you see, from the point of view of the standard orbifold way of describing these things, what this Twining genera you would describe by would be in this box notation, you would consider the untwisted sector, then you insert the group element G inside the twisted sector. And then there is this sort of general law of orbifolds that under a modular transformation, this combination where you twist the torus partition function one way and the other way, under the modular transformation you pick up certain combinations of these group elements to the appropriate powers. So if you start with one G, so if H is equal to 1, then you're going to get H is equal to 1 again, if B, you don't care with this, but C should be better equal to 0 mod N, where N is the order of G, so that this becomes again 1. And then you have to make sure that this becomes again G, or maybe G to the minus 1, and actually it's enough to require that it's, for the mature group, it's enough to require that it's equal to 1 mod N. And then what you see is that this defines for you a certain subgroup of the modular group, under which this diagram should go back to itself. It's a subgroup of the modular group, it's just gamma 0 n, it's precisely the subgroup of SL3C, for which this lower component C is equal to 0 mod n, because that's the condition that guarantees that you're going to get the one here. You know that this finding general should be invariant under this congruent subgroup, but if you draw these boxes, then you're never quite sure whether you get exactly the same function or the same function up to some phase. So you have to allow for the possibility of a multiplier system. So in this box notation, you don't see this, but there's really secretly, you don't see it here. There's the potential for a phase appearing here, because this orbital point of view just tells you it's going to be a function that has the same functional property, but it could be rescaled by some phase. And indeed, these phases are necessary in order for this to make this to work. And you have to guess what the phases are before you can use this modular approach in order to efficiently characterize these functions and be able to guess. So what we did was that we made a comparison for what this multiplier phase should be. And the comparison that we made is that this twining genus under modular transformations. So it has the usual stuff, but the interesting piece is e to the 2 pi by c times d over n times h. Well, this is only true for c equal to 0 mod n, because that's the congruent subgroup under which I should expect this to be invariant. So you see c over n will always be an integer, but this will be a non-trivial phase if h is bigger than 1. So if h is equal to 1, this will be a trivial phase. But if h is bigger than 1, then this phase will be non-trivial for some choice of c. So what we did is we simply proposed that that's the correct transformation property, and then we wrote down a list of the values of h for all the contiguous classes. It was later observed by Duncan and Chang that the list we wrote down is a simple interpretation. It's simply the length of the shortest cycle when you write down the conjugacy class in terms of the cycle decomposition and the permutation. So in particular, you see from that remember M23 has the property that it leaves one point fixed. So therefore, it always has a cycle of length 1. And therefore, h is always equal to 1 for M23. And therefore, there will never be a multiplier phase for the M23 conjugacy class, but there will be one.
Since you said all these conjugacy classes are actually metrically similar, it should be possible to use that to determine this.
Well, not all of them actually metrically. Some of them act, some never. That was what I was. So I had this slide previously. So these are the ones that actually metrically, these are the ones that never. So for these, I can calculate them somewhere, and I should be able to determine this. But you see, they all sit inside M23, so for them, the multiplier phase will be trivial. But for the other ones, I can't use this. Anyway, so at this stage, this is just a proposal, if you wish. This is a guess. And obviously, if you're a skeptic, you may think that maybe you did a wrong guess. So what we did is we made this guess, and then we found the explicit formula for all twining genera, that is, all 26 conjugacy classes, we wrote down the function. We actually have only 21 different functions, because there are sort of conjugacy class that keep the same function, but there are all the 21 formulae we wrote down. And actually, about a week, indeed this was a week, or after us, Eguchi and Nikami obtained the same twining genera independently. They used the eta product, the cycle shape type point of view, and they guessed also independently the same formula. Now, once you've got this formula, there's a very non-trivial test you can do on your analysis, because you see, this formula gives you access to the trace over these Rn's with the insertion of G for any group element in M24 and for all n's. Because you see, this is a closed formula for the whole twining genus, so this is true at every conformal dimension n, and therefore you can read off from them all of these traces Rn with the insertion of G. But then using the standard orthogonality of group characters, that means this determines each of these Rn uniquely as an M24 representation. So if you've done this wrong, you would get garbage. But what you find is, if you do this, if you now decompose this, each of these multiplicity spaces in representation of M24, and you've done this explicitly for the first 500 terms, what you find is you get positive integer combination of irreducible representations of M24. And the fact that it's positive integers means that in some sense you're doing something self-consistent. So then Eguchi and Nikami put out their paper that was a week later. They obviously had a bit more of 9, so they calculated the first 600 coefficients, and it also worked for them. And then I think Ferrer and Tachikawa has calculated the first 1,000 coefficients by running out of this laptop. And Terry Gannon tells me that this will be enough to prove it true for all. If first, then you can use multiple arguments to know that if this integrality and positivity condition is true for the sufficiently many coefficients, then you can prove that it's going to be true for all. And therefore, if you wish, this in some sense proves the DOT conjecture, maybe we have found a decomposition of all the multiplicity spaces in terms of N24 representations in such a way that all these fine general are the expected modular properties. So in some sense we've proven it, but we're not any cleverer, because we have just written down these functions and we haven't understood why it should be true. So what I want to explain to you now is how one may go about trying to understand where this comes from, not just sort of proving on a sort of more technical level. And the obvious idea would be that you try to explain it sort of in the spirit of the Mukai theorem. So the Mukai theorem is sort of classical geometry, but obviously here we are talking about the superconformal features, we talk about sigma models. So what you should try to look at is what are the most general symmetries that preserve the right structure. This is they must preserve the n equals to 4, 4, so that they just act on the multiplicity spaces, etc. So you should classify all the possible symmetry groups that you find anywhere in this modulized space of K3 surfaces. So that's what we've done. So this, at the point in this modulized space is really characterized by labeling a full plane inside this space up to these discrete identifications. And what we argued is, and that's sort of the precise thing we then analyzed, is that the symmetries, the interesting symmetries that are relevant for Mathieu Mundschein, are those symmetries of this discrete group which leave this four-plane pointwise invariant. You see, this group acts on this lattice that was embedded in this R4,20, and you can ask how these group generators act on these points in time, and you should look at the subgroup of 0,420 values in Z that leave every point on this four-dimensional plane inside this 4,20 space pointwise fixed. And then you can use sort of the same spirit as Kondo's theorem of the Mukai theorem to classify what the possible symmetry groups are that you find as you go through the full modulized space of K3 sigma models. So that's what we've done, and that's the answer. So the answer is that the following symmetry groups arise. So there are four cases. So case number one is that a group is equal to the key prime. So this is the same notation we just used. So this means this is a normal subgroup, and if you quotient by this, you get this group, where G double prime is a subgroup of M24. And G prime is a subgroup from the set 2 to the 12. Sorry, 2 to 11. But you don't get all possible subgroups of M24. They have to have at least 4 orbits when written as a permutation. So this is case number 1. And then case number 2 is that it's the extra special group 5 1 plus 2, so that's a special group of order 5 to the cube. Semi-direct product G4. And then H3 and H4, that it's equal to some powers of Z3, with acted on by the alternating group of 6 symbols. And then finally, the last one is that G is equal to the extra special group 3 and 4. Semi-direct product with Z2, and that's a normal subgroup sitting inside one prime, the triple prime maybe, or the not confuse it with the other one, and this is either 1 or Z2 or Z2. So that's the answer you find, and it really comes from looking at the possible symmetries that this four-dimensional plane can have. The strategy is that you look at the orthogonal component of the plane that's fixed by G, so the plane inside the R4,20 on which the group acts non-trivially, and then you can argue that you can embed this into the Nietzsche lattice, and then you can, by studying more carefully what possibilities arise, you get all of these possible subgroups of the Conway group. They're all possible subgroups of the Conway group because they all come from symmetries of the Nietzsche. So these are the possible symmetry groups, and I've written them down here because in the following I want to say something about the different possibilities that arise. So what's the the first comment is that none of the K3 sigma models has M24 as a symmetry group, because if you look at the list, that's showing not M24, that's not M24, that's not M24, and that is a proper subgroup of M24, because it has to, when written out, every element has to have a cyclic decomposition which has four orbits, and therefore in this these conjugacy class of M24 will never act as a symmetry on any point in the moduli space of this K3 sigma. So the most naive explanation of Mathieu-Moonshan would have been to find the most symmetrical of all K3 sigma models, which would have M24 as a symmetry group, and then that would have immediately implied that you get all of this structure, but what this tells you is that that's not possible. There is no K3 sigma model that has M24 as a morphism. Now the second comment refers to the fact that there are these other cases here. You see there are some K3 sigma models that have symmetries that are not contained in M24. So for example, if you look at case 2, you see this has 3 powers of 5, and you probably can't remember, but if you look at the order of M24 and the prime factor decomposition, it didn't have, it has less than 3 factors of 5 in the prime factor decomposition of M24. So you're sure that this can never be a subgroup of M24, and likewise for case 3 and case 4. So it's all of these special cases, special K3 sigma models that have symmetries that do not lie inside M24. In fact, this can also happen obviously in case 1, because you see in case 1, we have this additional factor G prime, and if this additional factor G prime is non-trivial, then it's also not a subgroup of M24. Because I mean, this is written as something that is a subgroup of M24 plus some rest, and if there's some rest, then it's also. So in some sense we got more than we bargained for. We hope to explain M24, but we're not quite getting M24. We always get a little bit less, but sometimes we get a little bit more. So this is sort of a what I was trying to hint at. This is a little bit a mixed message here. It's not really yet explaining why Montius Moonshine should be true. It's just telling you what you find when you do the analog of the Moonhai theorem applied to the sigma. And then the last comment is that all symmetry groups fit inside a convex group, or maybe some quotient of the convex group. This comes automatically from the way we do it, because they're all sub-symmetries of the Leech lattice. But when you look at the elliptic genus and you've looked at the first few coefficients and you try to write as dimensions of irreducible representations of the convex group, you just fail very, very, very bad. It just doesn't fit at all. The dimensions of the convex group are far too large in order to get the 90 coefficient. It just doesn't work. So this is I'm afraid this is the situation. So there is sort of partial explanation of it. We see some pieces of M24, but you certainly don't see all of M24. And I think what this tells you is that this point of view is maybe not quite the right point of view of trying to explain Mathieu-Moonshan. I should say though that there's a little bit of progress we have made recently in that we understand a little bit better the emergence of these special cases. So this is work I've been doing together with Roberto Volpatero. And this is what we have shown is that all the cases in, so for example, case 2 is net always a set 5 orbifold of T4. And cases 3 and 4 are always at 3 orbifolds of T4. So every K3 sigma model with symmetry folds in case 2, 3, and 4 will be a cyclic orbifold of a torus. And we also have shown that every K3 surface that is a cyclic torus orbifold will always contain symmetry generators that will not sit inside case 3 and 4. So let me briefly sketch to you how you can prove this. The idea is very, very simple. I should also say at this stage, in case you are worried about the Z5 orbifold of T4, this is obviously an asymmetric Z5 action. There is no symmetric Z5 action on T4, but there is an asymmetric Z5 action, and we've actually constructed the sigma model explicitly, and we've shown that it fits this picture. So how do you prove this? Well, the basic idea of the argument is, if the K3 sigma model is a cyclic torus orbifold, then this means it must have a symmetry by which, if you orbifold the K3 by, you're going to get T4. That's just the general statement that when you have the abelian orbifold, then you can always undo the orbifold by orbifolding the orbifold by the constant. I mean, you orbifold by the symmetry that acts with the appropriate phases in the various twisted sector, and that way you go back to the original abelian. That is always possible for abelian orbifolds. So if your K3 is a torus orbifold, then it must have a symmetry Z tilde or G tilde, giving rise to a symmetry group Z tilde M, so that if I orbifold K3 by the symmetry generator, I'm going to get T4. actually not that difficult. On the periscope, it has a symmetry G of order n. So I think of this as being the quantum symmetry that gives me 954, assuming I'm sitting at the Probe's orbifold point. And it better satisfies level matching, so I can actually orbifold by it. From the point of view I'm describing it here, this means you should have a trivial multiplier phase, so that the orbifold is consistent. So I can look at that. Then you see I can always calculate the elliptic genus of the orbifold theory by standard orbifold techniques. So this will be the sum of all twist detectors with all the projection in each twist detector by the appropriate power of the group element, and I just sum of all pairs, and I get the order of the group to implement the projection in each of the twist detectors. But you see, if in the case that it's a cyclic orbifold, then each of these twisted twining genera can be obtained from the twining genus of some power of G. The power is the greatest common divisor of I, J, and N by a suitable modular transformation. So I know that this function here I can calculate by calculating the modular transformation of the twining genus. I think with the insertion of one, the G to the D after a suitable modular transformation. But you see, in order to decide whether I get T4 or K3, the only thing I have to look at is not the full elliptic genus. It's enough to evaluate the elliptic genus at z equal to 0, because the elliptic genus of K3 is phi 0, 1, and the elliptic genus of T4 is 0, and the elliptic genus of K3 evaluated at z equal to 0 is 24. So I can distinguish these two cases by evaluating the function at one point. So this is what I'm saying here. The orbifold is a torus theory, if and only if its elliptic genus vanishes, and it therefore in particular vanishes at t equal to 0, and c equal to 0 is all I need to look at in order to sum this. But you see, for c equal to 0, then I know that the twining genus will only pick up a contribution from the master spectrum, so from the trace of the 24 states that make up the master piece of the elliptic genus. And this is obviously a constant, because there's a q to 0 in the elliptic genus, and therefore if I apply a modular transformation to a constant, it's going to be the same constant. Modular transformation doesn't do anything to this constant, and therefore this twisted twining genus evaluated at 0 is just equal to the trace of the 24 of this group element, where the power of the group element is determined in terms of I, J, and N. So therefore, I can write down the elliptic genus of the orbifold evaluated at z equal to 0 in terms of things that I just need to know the actual 24 of the powers of G. And you see this, this 24 is actually the standard 24-dimensional representation of the convey group, and therefore this only depends on the conjugation classes of the convey group in which the symmetry generator sits. So if I have a symmetry generator, then I can calculate this as long as I know in which conjugacy class of the convey group it sits, because then I can simply read off from the character table of the convey group what the trace of the 24-dimensional representation of the convey group is. So for each potential symmetry generator of my K3, I can calculate this number, and therefore I can calculate the elliptic genus by the putative orbifold of my K3 by this group. So this is what we've done. The convey group has 167 conjugacy classes, but only 42 contain symmetries that can be realized by some K3 sigma model, because remember there's a small print in this theorem. And then of these 42, there are 31 that have necessarily a trivial multiplier phase, since the trace over the 24-dimensional representation is non-trivial. So in 31, you can orbifold, and when you orbifold them, you find that the elliptic genus is either equal to 24, this happens in 21 cases, or it's equal to 0, that happens in 10 cases. So all the conjugacy classes that correspond to here are conjugacy class. If I orbifold my K3 by, I get T4, which means in turn that the K3 I started from was actually a torus orbifold by the dual symmetry with quantum symmetry one. So what this you learn by this is that a quantum symmetry of T4 orbifold is always exceptional, and therefore if your K3 is a T4 orbifold, it will have a quantum symmetry, and the quantum symmetry will necessarily not lie in M24, and therefore it will be one of the exceptional cases in this theorem. So you also have to worry about the remaining 11 cases. You see, these 31 cases you are sure work. The remaining 11 cases, you're not quite sure whether they will be satisfied level matching or not. In all but one case of them, the elliptic genus is actually not equal to 0 and 24. That just tells you that you've done something illegal and you are duly punished for it. because you get an answer that doesn't make any sense. There's one case where we also get zero. We don't know whether that means it was a consistent orbifold or not, but in any way, it would be a Torres orbifold, and the corresponding class is also not the N24. So what you conclude from that is that if the sigma model is a cyclic Torres orbifold, then it always has a symmetry, namely quantum symmetry, that's not part of the N24. And in some sense, that explains all of these cases, and some cases are here. So many of these cases are accounted for by this special K3s that are Torres orbifolds. So this is the other statement I make. You see, in this case, you know that this case contains a certain conjugacy class of Conway, so the N24, and when you look at this formula, if you calculate at this formula, what you find for it is that it's equal to zero, so it's a Torres orbifold, and therefore you conclude it's E4 over Z5, and you've actually constructed this Z5 orbifold explicitly and checked the difference of life. So this is true, and then by a similar type of argument, you prove it in the So what this tells you is that all the exceptional K3, there are exceptional K3 sigma models in case one, in this case, that are not cyclic Torres orbifolds, because we can tell from this argument whether things are cyclic Torres orbifolds or not. But we don't know whether they are non-abelian orbifolds, that we can't analyze from that point of view. And also, to be honest, I don't really understand what the significance of cyclic Torres orbifolds. I'm just telling you that in this funny classification, the 3 out of 4 cases that look funny are indeed only realized by cyclic Torres orbifolds. Whether that has any meaning or not, I'm not aware. So this is, I think, as far as we've managed to get by studying symmetries of K3 sigma models and explaining much in moonshine. And what you should take away from this is that it's a little bit of a mixed bag. So we understand bits, but then there are bits that don't really seem to fit with this mature moonshine observation. So recently, we've therefore sort of followed another avenue. What we've tried to do is analyze the analog of Norton's generalized moonshine functions. So this is what I would like to call twisted twining general. So this is, you calculate these boxes where both of these group elements are non-trivial. And obviously, these two group elements have to be commuting pairs of group elements in N24. Now, the main observation of what we have done is that we've managed to find formulas for all of them, but the key observation that gives me some hope that this is maybe a good way to think about it is that these twisted twining genera behave exactly as twisted twining characters of a holomorphic orbifold of operator algebra behave. So let me remind you what I mean by this, and then I'll explain to you in which sense they behave that way. So holomorphic orbifolds have been studied for a long time, and there is this observation that if you calculate all of these twisted twining genera, twisted twining characters, you can normalize them in such a way that under the T modular transformation and the S modular transformation, they pick up specific phases. And these phases you can calculate in terms of a 3 cocycle of the group with values in U1. And a 3 cocycle of the group with values in U1 characterizes this function CH, G1, G2, and in turn characterizes the modular behavior of all of these twisted twining in general. So this is the formula for what this means is that holomorphic orbifolds are characterized secretly by a choice of a 3 cocycle in this cohomology group. This 3 cocycle determines all of these functions, which are actually 2 cocycles on the centralizer, and then they determine the modular behavior of all of these twisted twining in general. Now, in our case, we don't have a VOA. We have this elliptic genus. There is no single conformal field theory that underlies it. But what we observe is that, first of all, we have been told that the third cohomology of N24, which is in U1, is Z12. And you see, this Z12 ties in quite nicely with this multiplier phase here. You see, this multiplier phase here is trivial for N23. But the values h it takes are all factors of 12. And actually, the 12 b conjugates that h equals precisely to 12. So the cocycles, the multiplier phases that you have to get, must be 12 roots of unity. And indeed, that ties together with the fact that the third cohomology of N24 with values in U1 is precisely at 12. And what we found formula for all the twisted twining general, such that the multiplier phases show exactly this behavior under modular transformations, where the corresponding 3 cocycle is just the primitive that three-co-cycle, then the two co-cycles are determined by this, fix all of these modular formulas. So again, we have found formulas for all of them, and we cross-check them by checking that they lead to decompositions of the G-twisted sector in terms of representations of the stabilizer of G, as you would expect, and indeed the representations we find are projective representations whose projectivity property is characterized by these functions that define two cohomology elements of the group that characterize the projective representation. And what we find again is that when you look at the G-twisted sector, you get positive integer decompositions of representations of this. So that suggests that all of that again fits well together, but what it does suggest is that all of these phases behave as though they would come from an honest EOA, because they really come from this free cosine that seems to be program. I should also mention that many of these this defining general are actually equal to zero, and that comes from the fact that there are interesting obstructions. So actually, many of these things are zero, and most of the zeros we've understood as arising from obstruction of that sort. Maybe this phase must be equal to one for this finding genus to be non-zero if A commutes with G and H. Then obviously this is the same as this, and this can only be non-zero if this factor is one, and there are examples where it's not one, and then you know automatically that the thing is zero. So in view of time, let me conclude. I feel on a certain level that Jung Moonshine has been established on the level of constructing this twining genera, this twisted twining genera, you get decompositions, that all works nicely. But if you're looking for sort of a microscopic understanding in terms of symmetries of K3 sigma models, I think it's still somewhat not clear. It's not clear what you should see precisely in M24. It's not clear whether there's anything special about Horace or before. So it's not, I think the situation is essentially not clear. But what I feel is that the fact that this twisted twining genera a structure that is precisely as for holomorphic BOAs suggests to me that there should be some sort of underlying BOA explanation. So the way I tend to think about it, that there should be some sort of BPS algebra, some algebra that you obtain by going through the cohomology that just keeps track of the BPS states. And actually you find an algebra that whose automorphism group is the mature group, and that would then explain all of these properties. But this M24 is not a symmetry that would act on the full conformity theory associated to any K3 sigma model, but maybe one should truncate it by going to some suitable cohomology. Maybe on the resulting object there is a good M24. So I think of this as the situation here, a little bit sort of opposite to monstrous moonshine. In monstrous moonshine, you have this the monster CFT and the generalized Kac-Moody algebra that explains it, but you are lacking some sort of geometric intuition, and there's this old idea of Fetzerbruch that there should be this 24-dimensional manifold that somehow realizes it. Here we have plenty, well, we have a manifolds that sort of realize parts of it, but we are missing the underlying algebraic reason for this to work, so I think there should be something like a BPS algebra, and I think that would be very interesting to find it. And the fact that all of it fits so nicely together makes me very confident that something like that should exist, but I don't have a good proposal at the moment how to construct. So,
yes? Are there questions? Yes. Actually, regarding your last remark, it seems to me that the analogy to the FLM theory would, if this worked out, would be pretty good. They showed that the dimension 2 primary is
explain, but it's not completely obvious that that's how you work, Greg. Part of the problem is that when you rewrite, when you write the character, there are 20 massless states with j equals 0, there are 2 massless states with j equals a half, and then you have the sum of mass representations. And while there's a mathematical rewriting that gives you a 24, you still can't avoid the fact that the massless representations, without introducing virtual representations, don't have a natural action of M24. So in order to make this algebra work, including the massless states, which will certainly arise as part of the OPE, you have to understand what's going on with these virtual representations. And I don't think that's really understood yet.
Yeah, and so you want to understand that then, in the realm of the elliptic genus, where you have minus 1 to the f, the fact that you get virtual representation is not so shocking. So,
no, it's not shocking,
but still you have to understand where it's going. I totally agree that we haven't understood it. That's why I'm saying this is, I think, the way it should be explained, and I haven't yet explained it that way, but I think there's some promise in that. Nice to somehow compare the action on non-perturbative to perturbative states to find out that there's some compatibility which tells you you should pick some subject S24 acting on that object, and I don't know anything.